I just want to share something with you very quickly as we get started this morning. And I know that, you know, pastors do all kinds of crazy things. And I've been known as one of the craziest. But I want you to realize that I went into this summer, and now it's kind of bled over into the fall a little bit, with the intention to grow the core of the church, which the people that are most faithful, the people that come all the time, you know, are the core of the church. So this push to discipleship, this push for you to grow, because I believe this, if the core of the church is not strong in their faith and their walk with Jesus Christ, then who's going to have an impact in this world? As we have visitors come in and as people and events and we do different things, I mean, we need to be Jesus to everybody. And so, and I know, and to be honest with you, I'll be honest with you, even when I started down this path of Daniel, my intention was for us to see how Daniel was molded and formed by God. But as I've gotten into it, this journey of Daniel has actually been forming and molding me to understand the responsibility that I have to grow you. Because if I don't stand before you as the pastor of the church and teach about things that are really heavy, where are you going to get it? I mean, I don't see, unless you're really someone who loves theology or somebody who loves to really get into the Word and to dive into things that are a little bit difficult, usually the normal person doesn't want to do that. And so I want you to bear with me. We got really three more Sundays of this, Daniel. And the reason that we have three more Sundays is because Daniel chapter 11 is so deep, and it's 48 verses, that there's no way I could lay it all on you today. And I want you to know that I've studied harder for this sermon today than any other sermon I've ever studied. Rabbis and theologians will tell you that Daniel chapter 11, in their opinion, is the most difficult chapter in the whole Bible. In the whole Bible. Because there's so much going on that's happening here. As we see right now at the beginning of chapter 11, chapter 10 goes right into chapter 11. And we learned last week that spiritual warfare is real, that the angels battle on our behalf. Not only what's going on, but what's going to happen in the future. And so when we think about future, we think about angels, we think about spiritual realms, we think about all these things, it's like, woo, I do that again, but I can't. But I want you to know that we have an awesome, mighty God that we just sang about, who deserves our praise and our worship, because he's got it all under control. He's got it all under control. Last week we talked about being present with the Lord. No matter what's going on, no matter what's happening, and we see in Daniel's life, no matter what else was going on or pulling at him or whatever decrees or different things that the king might say, Daniel stayed faithful in the presence of God all the time. He didn't waver from his prayer times. He didn't let someone else influence him what he was going to eat, what he was going to do, how he was going to act. No, he only allowed one person to influence him, and that was God. And so I wonder sometimes, even for myself, if, man, and I've been praying especially this week, Lord, help me to be present with you more. I want to be present with you more. I want to feel you. I want to experience you. I want everything that you want for me in my life. Just because I stand up here before you, I am the exact same as you. I don't want you to ever put me on a pedestal or look at me as anything other than just you. I'm a sinner saved by grace just like you. I have struggles just like you. I deal with stuff just like you. I'm a little crazier than you, but that's my personality. But we're all in this together. And we need the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit to guide us, direct us, and lift us up. Amen? Present with the Lord. I love that. So here we go. Daniel chapter 11. And I encourage you to have your Bibles out today, because we're going to go from Daniel chapter 11 to Matthew 24 to Luke chapter 11. There's also some, I'm not going to go in there, but I want you to know today in Daniel chapter 11, there's stuff going on in Isaiah, there's stuff going on in Jeremiah, there's stuff going on in Zechariah. God wanted to make sure that this message of what was going to happen in the future got out to his people. Why? Because he doesn't want you and me to be blindsided. He doesn't want some surprise to happen, that all of a sudden all these things are happening, and as Christians we go, well, why didn't God tell us? Well, he is, and he tells us very vividly in this thing called the Bible. This is the Word of God, just in case it's new to you, the Word of God, the Bible, and it's something that we need to spend a lot of time in, and that's what we're doing. So we see here in Daniel chapter 11, there's 45 verses, as I shared with you about that, and so we're going to split it up a little bit. But Daniel chapter 11 is world history from Darius to the time of the end. The first section of verses is 1 through 35. It describes the major rulers of the north and the south kingdoms, while at the same time intermixed as references to future prophecy. So not only is God telling Daniel what's going to be happening, and basically this is the period of 400 years going on between the Old Testament and the New Testament. You know, people will say, well, you know, nobody knows what's going on. Well, maybe they didn't read the book of Daniel. Because in the book of Daniel, if you look at all these different kings and all these different things, we can see how those that 400-year period evolves right down. Now, what was going on is that people weren't hearing from God. Why? Was it God's fault? No, they had all turned their back on him. They were worshiping other idols. They were worshiping other gods. They were believing in these kings. It's so interesting as you see and you go through it. As I've looked at history this week, historical references, all kinds of different things. And it's funny, even the children of Israel, they're as bad as anybody else, or what we see going on in the Middle East and everything, is they would jump from one side to the other side depending on who they thought was going to win. I think some of that happens in our own country. I want to be on the winning team, right? Pretty crazy. So then verses 36 through 45, skip right over the present church age. That's what we're in right now, is the church age. And goes right into the last Gentile ruler, which we know is going to be the Antichrist. But he will only get to rule for a short period of time, because the mightiest one of all, Jesus Christ, is going to come and return. And he's going to usher in his new kingdom. So the main idea here of chapter 11, and it's in your notes, I encourage you to take out your notes too, is God knows about the future in advance and reigns sovereign over the rise and fall of all kingdoms, great and small, directing history according to his providential plan. I want us to not doubt that God is in control. God is in control. There's some interesting things also that I learned, and I want you to know that end times, eschatology as they call it, is such a big deal that there are Jewish rabbis, there's all kinds of theologians, there's people that are meeting quarterly, these people that know more about the Word of God, and they're meeting quarterly, and they have these forums in different parts of the world where they come together, they have the Word of God out, and they begin to dive in, and they're trying to figure out what God's going to do next. But we know that Jesus said that only the Father knows the time. But also we know that it says that towards the end that more wisdom and things will be imparted upon us. And so I think that they're trying to gain wisdom too. I don't believe they're trying to be cocky or anything, but this means so much to them that they're doing everything they can to be ready for when Jesus Christ returns. Because see, some of the Jewish people, some of these rabbis and stuff, they don't believe that the Messiah has come yet, and so they're looking for him to come. And then those that do believe that he's already come are excited about his second return. Either way, we're all excited that Jesus is coming back. So some key themes here, and we're just going to dive into the first 20 verses today, is the angelic messenger reveals the transfer of world power. And Jerusalem is caught in the middle of the war, threatened by the powerful king of the north. And we're going to get into that a little bit. But it's amazing. Chapter 11 is intense. There's lots of wars, lots of power struggles. I want you to hear this. There's a great lust for power, lust for prestige, a great lust for possessions. And what we've seen, have seen the power behind all these things, we've seen clear back to Genesis chapter 4, so I talked about the story of Cain and Abel. Sin is behind all of it. And so I want you to know that nothing's changed. People today lust for prestige. People today lust for wealth. People today lust for power. People today lust for position. I want to be number one. I want you all to bow down to me. Hey, that's what a lot of people, they might not say those words, but a lot of these corporate execs, a lot of people in government, there's a lot of people that look at themselves a little bit higher than I think they should. That's a judgmental statement, so Lord, forgive me for being judgmental, but I believe it to be true. So let's look to see, before we get into Daniel, what Jesus Christ has to say in Matthew 24. So if you have your Bibles and your scripture, turn to Matthew 24 for a moment. We're not going to read the whole thing, but the whole thing is the signs of the end of the age. But I want to just hit on a few scriptures. Jesus comes right out and he says, watch out that no one deceives you. That no one deceives you. Because there's going to be a lot of deception going on. A lot of things happen. He says in verse 6, you will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not alarmed. Such things must happen. Now, I want you to hear this very importantly this morning. See, future prophecy for us as believers, as Christians, should excite us and encourage us. We don't have to worry about what's going on. It should excite us and encourage us on our journey, that the God that we serve, the Jesus Christ that we've surrendered our lives to, he cares about every little detail, not only about us, but about what's going on. But we know there'll be social instability, there'll be natural disasters, all kinds of things are going to be going on. Verse 13 says, but he who stands firm to the end will be saved. Will be saved. So let's back up for a second. Verse 7 says, nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places, and all these are the beginning of birth pains. So wars, kingdoms against kingdoms. Daniel, what he's talking about? The north kingdom against the south kingdom against the north kingdom. Goes back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. At that time, many will turn away from their faith and will betray and hate each other. Many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. Because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold. But he who stands firm to the end will be saved. And then Jesus talks about Daniel. Verse 15, he says, so when you see standing in the holy place the abomination that causes desolation, standing in the holy place, see what the deal is. The Antichrist wants control of the Holy Land, wants control of Jerusalem. That's what's been going on for a long time. As a matter of fact, the king of the north, right before his fall, he actually finally gets into Jerusalem and sets up an image, an idol of Zeus, right in the temple where God used to be worshipped and praised, where the God of heaven. Think that made God feel good? No. And we see what happens to, I think that was Antiochus III that did that, and we see what happens to him very quickly after that. So don't be messing with God. Don't be putting stuff in his temple. But that's the thing. But also at the same time, we see that God is allowing all these things to happen because he wants Israel to repent. God wants Israel to repent. Okay, so I want you to see something and know something. This is very important. Israel before Jesus was a place. Okay, when you understand this, Israel, Jerusalem, the Holy Land, all that, it was a place before Jesus because why? God dwelled where? In the temple, right? Now, where does God dwell after Jesus? In us. See, God wants everyone to repent. When the Bible says that God wants Israel to repent, he wants us all to repent. Because of Jesus Christ, it doesn't matter, Jew, Gentile, whatever, what matters is if you've accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, if Jesus is number one in your life, if you live your life surrendered to the working of the Holy Spirit in your life, that's what makes a difference. That's what God wants. Because God wishes that none should perish, right? But that all would experience eternal life. Is that, are you guys good so far? We okay? All right. So here's the question we asked today out of Daniel. Are you trusting in God to be your deliverer, or do you look to other individuals and things to give you security? See, this is at the what is at the heart of Daniel chapter 11 that we're studying today. I want you to know that, I found a rabbi, and it's a really cool story that this rabbi, his name is Dr. Baruch, and he, being a rabbi, used to just believe in the Old Testament stuff, but God got a hold of him, and he is now a born-again believer, and he accepted Christ as his Lord and Savior, and because of that, he is trying to help the Jewish nation and Jewish people to understand about God. So he is a professor of Hebrew in Jerusalem area in Israel. And he has six, and you can look him up on YouTube, and I encourage you to do this. He has six 30-minute segments just on Daniel chapter 11, and it's phenomenal. And the reason that I did this and was motivated this, because I probably have, and I bought two more this week, 14 commentaries on the book of Daniel. And as I was looking through all 14 commentaries, they were all saying a bunch of different things. I mean, usually commentarists, you know, they vary a little bit because of their theological bent and whatever. But man, I mean, from one side to the other. And so I go, I need someone who's got a little bit more in this game. And so this rabbi, and so I looked it up as he goes through and he kicks it verse by verse. And he takes the Hebrew meanings. And so I've got my Hebrew Bible and stuff, and so I was looking up what he was saying, and what he was saying was right on the money, was true. And so I believe this guy because he's sharing his heart, not trying to sell a book, but trying to help people to see the truth about who God is. So YouTube, and speaking of YouTube, you know, all our sermons now are on YouTube. We're the only Sunrise Community Fellowship on YouTube. If you look up Sunrise Community Church or Sunrise Church or whatever, we're the only community fellowship. And so sermons are on there, and especially Revelation. Daniel, I'm going to have to watch them several times again so I know what's going on. This is heavy stuff, but it's important. It's important for you and me to be informed about what God is at work doing and why he's at work doing it. He's doing it for you and for me. Very important for us to understand that. All right. Faithful people rise to the top. As we look at Daniel's life, we can see that this is true. Many leaders rise and fall all the time, but God's faithful will endure forever. God's faithful will endure forever. All right, let's dive into Daniel chapter 11. We'll get in there now. God supports and protects as he chooses. As we look at verse 1 and 2, in the verse 1 here, this is a hinge verse, and they call it a hinge verse, theologians do, because chapter 10 doesn't actually end. Chapter 10 just goes right into chapter 11. And so they put those chapters and verses in there to help coordinate things. But chapter 10, so this is a hinge verse, goes right into 11. And so we see that the angel is still speaking here. And so it says, the angel at the beginning of 10 informs Daniel he has come to strengthen and protect Darius the Mede, King Cyrus. And this is important, and there's going to be a bunch of stuff, and I hope you can stay with me today because it all fits together, and if you see it, I've been excited all week because this is awesome stuff. And I hope I'm not boring you because I'm not trying to, but this is good. So this is important because the same year that Cyrus issued that the angel came, he issued a decree to allow the Jews to go back to Israel. Because, see, the Jews were in captivity in Babylon this whole time, and now the Persians and Medes have taken over, and this King Cyrus or Darius the Mede, however you want to pronounce it, he's got several names. Important people have lots of different names. Anyway, it all means the same guy. He allows the people to go back to Jerusalem. Well, the reason that this is so important is because Nehemiah, if you remember the story of Nehemiah, Nehemiah needed all these people to be back in Jerusalem so he could rebuild the walls and rebuild the gates, right? Very, very important. And so without the people there, he couldn't do this. And another reason this is so important is because we'll see, but Jerusalem is right in the middle of all these battles. The king of the north, the king of the south, Jerusalem sits right smack dab in the middle of all this stuff. And if Nehemiah, Ezra, and all them wouldn't have went back and rebuilt Jerusalem, it would have been devastated and it would not be there today. But because they went back, rebuilt the city became this pillar, this thing that was like, that they fought over all the time. But God continued to protect it. very, very important for us to see that. Okay, there's a lot on the slide, so I don't want you to get messed up. But verse 2 says, now then I tell you, so I, first person, it's the angel. This is the angel talking. Tell you the truth. That word truth in Hebrew means give wisdom. The angel is saying, Daniel, I am giving you wisdom about future things that are going to happen. Does that make sense? Given wisdom. Three more kings will arise in Persia. So we know that Darius is one. And so we see in Ezra now, Ezra spells out who the other two of these three kings are. Xerxes and then in the days of of Persia. That guy. Xerxes. That's what I'm going to say. Anyway, and then we see he goes on to talk about, and why that's important is because Artaxerxes is who Nehemiah was a cupbearer for and who allowed Nehemiah to leave, okay, gave Nehemiah letters to all these other kings, letters to the guy in charge of the forest and everything to get all the materials to rebuild Jerusalem. You see how it all fits together? See, that's why reading the whole Bible and how it all fits together is so important. Are you following me or am I boring you? You want me to stop? Okay, good. All right, let's go. Good. All right, so this all this stuff is going on, and we see that as Nehemiah returns, what also starts to happen? People don't want him to rebuild Jerusalem. Why? Because they know it's such a pivotal place. But not only that, people feared God. Even though they might have worshipped other idols and stuff, there was enough stuff out there. There was enough documentation. There was enough words of mouth that went on about how God raised and destroyed people and how God was so powerful. And so they felt like if Jerusalem was wiped out and Jerusalem was no more, then the God of heaven that's this powerful God would be no more. But they were wrong. They were very wrong. So anyway, see, all this stuff works together. The other cool thing we see here is Daniel, when he was doing his 3 weeks of prayer, what was Daniel doing? He was praying for God to forgive the sins of the people, right? Do you remember that? He was praying for God to forgive the sins of the people. What was Nehemiah doing at the same time? Praying for God to forgive the sins of the people. Isn't that cool? So we see what happened is they're both praying. God gave both of them favor. Daniel had favor with all these kings and all these different people, and God protected his life. Nehemiah had favor with his very king, and not only that king, but all these other people that God allowed Nehemiah to be in leadership over to get this job accomplished. Very, very cool. Whew. Man, there's a lot there. Take a breath, Dean. Okay. All right, verse 3. God breaks and divides as he chooses. Then a mighty king will arise who will rule with great power and do as he pleases. Do as he pleases. So I want us to see something very important here. Now, this is one of those scriptures that is transitional not only to what was happening in the olden days, but what's going to happen with the Antichrist. What is the difference between Jesus Christ and the Antichrist? Day and night. Yeah, there you go. Day and night. Yeah, big difference. Jesus Christ does everything that the Father wants, right? Everything, he says, everything to the will of the Father, even to the point of going to the cross. But the Antichrist, with evil in his thing, is going to do anything and everything that he pleases. Anything and everything that he pleases, because he's motivated by evil. So I want you to see that right there. Okay, verse 4. After he is risen, his empire will be broken up and parceled out toward the four winds of heaven. Do you remember as we were in Daniel chapter 8, what was going on with that? Do you remember what animal it was that came and started causing destruction? The animal that you would think would be weaker? Giving out hints. He goes, bah! No, a sheep. That's not a good goat impression, huh? All right. It was the great goat, right? In Daniel chapter 8, it says, therefore the male goat grew very great, but when he became strong, the large horn was broken off, and in its place were four noticeable ones came up toward the four winds of heaven. Wow. So we know in the past what that meant was Alexander the Great, right? As they took over, then as Alexander the Great died, we know at a very young age, his four commanders took over and they established these four different areas. But it also was deeper than that, because we know that what it also means, because out of those four horns, what else popped up? A little horn after that, which was the Antichrist. And the Antichrist is going to try and spread out his control and his thing over. So if we look at the four winds and start the north, south, east, west, let the holy name be blessed all around the earth and sun. Let the there was a prayer that someone used to pray like that. Anyway, I don't know why that just popped into my head. Pretty weird. But anyway, the Antichrist wants to take over everything. And so that's what that means. Are you with me? Okay, so I want you to see here how this scripture continues. It said, it will not go as his descendants, nor will it have the power he exercised. Okay, so in this right here, power he exercised in the Hebrew, what they did, the scribes, it means other side. And the reason is because scribes back in the day, they were very superstitious. Remember, they wouldn't say the word Yahweh because Yahweh meant God. And if they said it incorrectly, they were worried that God would strike them dead. Right? Well, it's the same as they were scared of God, they were scared of somebody else too, called Satan. And so they didn't want to say his name wrong or even have anything to do with him. So they called him the other side. But that's what that means, the other side. See, you came to church today and you learned something, right? But the cool part for us is uprooted in the past. We see that, again, they've rose and fallen and stuff. But in the end, the Antichrist will be uprooted by Jesus Christ. Uprooted by Jesus Christ. So here we go. Let's look at Luke chapter 21, 27 through 28. It says, then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now, when these things begin to happen, look up and lift your heads. See, Christians, believers, why do we go around being a bunch of Eeyores? It doesn't matter what's going on today. It doesn't matter what's going on tomorrow. We're all going to be redeemed. Redemption draws near. We are redeemed, but we're going to be redeemed in this context out of all the junk that's going to be happening. Yep. Gene's right and I'm right. Just want to clarify that. We are redeemed, but we will be redeemed. And in this context, it means redeemed out. It means pulled out of all the things that are going to be happening in the last days. Because Jesus is talking about the last days right here. Very, very important for us. So this is why we should be excited, because our redemption draws near. Why? I'm not going to say it that way. God's pattern, as we see throughout history, is he raises people up and he tears people down. He holds the children of Israel accountable because why? Because they turn their backs on him, because they're in sin, because they're not doing the right thing. And then enough pressure gets put on him until what do? They fall on their face before him and they say, God, we sinned, we're sorry, we'll never do it again, please forgive us, please redeem us, please restore us. And then what does God do? He restores them, right? He delivers them. He does all those things. And you can see how this stuff happens. So I got ahead of myself. I already said all that stuff. Okay, good. All right. Daniel chapter 7. So verses 5 through 20, the king of the south and the king of the north are in constant battle. And again, this is all happening mostly during this 400-year period between the Old Testament and the New Testament. Each king wins their share of battles. During this time, there are different kings that rise up, and it's usually the son of somebody, the son of somebody, the son of somebody else, from the north and the south. But there's lots of betrayal also going on at the same time. And this is interesting, and the Bible spells this out, and I'm not going to go through it today because we don't have time. But as a king gets victory, they get full of pride, and they think, yeah, man, I've got it. We've got it now and stuff. And then what happens? Boom, right on their face. Full of pride. I think the Bible talks about that, something about the pride and humble and, yeah, you know what I'm saying. All right. So it all starts here in verse 5 with the king of the south, and we see what's going on. But there's some interesting things that I want to pull out for us this morning. Verse 6, after some years, they will become allies. And so we know that what happened was the king of the south just had taken over the king of the north, taken all his territory. But again, even though they were powerful and even though they'd done all these things, they just didn't quite have enough to really overtake the whole land and control it. So what used to happen in Old Testament days and stuff, they would do these things called marriage alliances. And so I'm going to give you my daughter in marriage, and I'm from the south, and you're from the north. I'm going to give you my daughter in marriage, and since now we have this blood connection thing a little bit, or at least a marriage connection going on, now we're going to be friends. We're going to be allies. We're going to work together. We're going to put an end to this bloodshed. We're going to put an end to all these different things. So this is what happened here. And so it says, the daughter of the king of the south will go to the king of the north and make an alliance. But she will not retain her power, and he and his power will not last. In those days, she will be betrayed together with her royal court and her father. So the daughter's name was Bernice, and she was given to Antiochus, number one. There's like eight Antiochuses. This is number one. It's at the beginning, verse 5, verse 6. Who then discarded his wife, and I can't say her name right, but L-A-O-D-I-C-A, Ladois, Ladice, Ladice. We'll call her Ladice. So he gets this new wife from the south, and so he kicks his wife out. Kind of a crazy deal, but, you know, those guys all had tons of wives. I don't know why he did that, but he kicked her out. But then 4 years later, he takes her back. Now, guys, you got to listen to this. Women never forget anything. They don't forget. And so what happened was she found the favor of Antiochus number one again. And so what does she do? She poisons him and kills him. And then she kills Bernice. She kills the child that they had together. She kills her court and kills her dad. She just kills them all. So then when this is going on in the south, a new king of the south rises up, and his name is Ptolemy number three. And so what does he want to do? He wants to get revenge for who? His sister. So here we go again. Fight war. So I know you're going, man, Pastor Dean, what does this have to do with me? Well, you're going to see as we move forward. So now we move forward to verse 16. So this battle has gone back and forth. And so each of these Antiochuses, these kings, now we're at number three, he becomes the most powerful one. I mean, he is stronger, bigger army, more money, all this stuff going on. Well, he also has a daughter. And so in his last escapade, in his last time now that he took over the king of the kingdom of the south, he actually moved into what's called the beautiful land, which is Israel. And so we see that he sets up this thing to Zeus, and he does all these things that he shouldn't be doing. But he feels like he's in control. And so he says, you know what, no more battles. I want to take over again. What I'm going to play this game from the playbook in the past. I'm going to send you my daughter down to the king of the south. And then we're going to have this little alliance going on, and then I'm going to be in control of all of it. Well, his daughter's name was, and it's a familiar one that you might have heard before in history, Cleopatra. And if any of you have studied the history of Cleopatra, which I looked at this week, because I know there's the whole Hollywood version, but there is a real Cleopatra. And not only that, there's more than one Cleopatra, because Cleopatra had daughters. And they named after her daughters Cleopatra number two, Cleopatra number three, Cleopatra number four. This is true. This is real. You can look it up. Don't take my word for it. Just like we have Antiochus number one, number two, you know, this is how they did it. So Cleopatra, she goes down to the south, and so she's hoping that her father is hoping that while she's there, you know, she's mesmerizing the king of the south with all her beauty and all of her stuff and everything, that, you know, that this whole thing will happen and that they'll be able to sneak in, and then boom, they'll be in total control. But she flips on her own dad. I mean, who would thought? Cleopatra decides that she wants power and control. And so looking up, it's pretty interesting. This Cleopatra says that she spoke three different languages. That not only that she studied underneath her, because her father was such a great military leader, she studied all of this military stuff that he did. And so not only did she, as her husband in the south mysteriously passes away, and she takes control. They don't have proof. They just say mysteriously passed away. It wasn't in battle because there was no wars going on at this time. But he passed away, then she takes control. But she is so smart militarily and speaking all these languages and stuff that all the people begin to follow her. And so now Cleopatra is in charge of the kingdom of the south. Woo! Pretty crazy. So what happens is her dad gets a little angry, right? But Cleopatra's smart. She doesn't just, you know how they line up and have these wars? She kind of fought more like how we see our Native Americans do it. She put together people in these regiments and put them all over the place. And so when her dad came with his mighty army, they got ambushed from all different places. And so they ran tail because they were overwhelmed. It felt like there was more military from the South than there actually was because of her strategy. Pretty interesting, huh? So he runs and gets back, and he goes back. And so, but what's all going on at the same time is there's this kingdom called Rome. I don't know if you've heard of Rome. So anyway, Rome starts to get in power. And so Antiochus III says, I got to do something about this. And so we see in verse 17, I think it is, that he starts going towards the coastlines. And so he starts going towards Rome and start having battles with Rome. But then what happens is Rome begins to outmatch him. And so he has to retreat back. And as he's retreating back the last time, Antiochus III disappears. They don't know what happened to him. They don't have any record that he was killed in battle. They think he might have drowned somewhere, but they have no record of his death. Pretty crazy going on. So Cleopatra, she grooms up her son, who becomes this Pelotima guy, whatever, or the fourth, fifth, or sixth, and fifth, I guess. And she turns the kingdom over to him. She's groomed him up, turns the kingdom over to him. She realizes that Rome is starting to become a power. And so what does she do? And if you know, Hollywood kind of portrays this a little better. She seeks out Julius Caesar. She seduces him. And all these different things begin to happen. And pretty crazy. So you better look that up and see if Pastor Dean knows what he's talking about. I don't think I do, but it's pretty cool. Anyway, there's a bunch of history here. But the reason I'm telling you all this is because now you can see that the Bible is true. The Bible is real. I mean, I believe it anyway and stuff. But how it all mixes in and how it all goes together. I know this seemed more like a history lesson today, but I'll get to the point. All right, here we go. What does this text teach us about fallen humanity? This is what it's all about. Really, God doesn't care about all the battles, all the different things. What he cares about is our soul and cares about a relationship with him. Man and his depravity, pride and sin has a bloodthirst for power and possessions. Is that yesterday or is that today? Happens everywhere, all the time, right? He fights wars doing whatever he wants if he can. Might makes right. I'm bigger, badder, and tougher, so I'm right. You got that, Steve Johnson? I just want to make sure you got that. Okay. I'm just kidding. I just like to pick on you. Man exalts his heart and inflates his sense of self-worth. Given the opportunity, he will trample over others with little or no regard for those who get hurt in the process. This is the story of human history since the fall and will continue to be our legacy until the return of God's King, which is Jesus, and the inauguration of his kingdom. This is the bottom line. This is what the angel is telling Daniel. This is what it's all about. We need to get our act together. We need to quit focusing on all these different things. As a matter of fact, one of the things that these rabbis and all these people get together and all this stuff's going on. In that scripture that I read to you earlier in Daniel 11, where it's talking about stir up, they have come to the conclusion it's Europe. And so when the Antichrist comes on the scene, he is going to try and make alliances with everybody, right? And so he's coming from the north. We know that much. The Bible tells us that the Antichrist is coming somewhere from the north, which northeast, north, over there somewhere. But we get all worried. I was talking to Terry Tucker about this yesterday. We get all worried about all kinds of crazy things and judgmental and get on our war thing about all this stuff about what our president's doing or what this is doing or what's doing that. I just want to let you know again, who's in control is God. And you know what? If Europe is going to side and have an alliance with the Antichrist, I don't want nothing to do with them. You know, they might have been our allies all throughout history and through these world wars. And the reason that they were allies is really, the bottom line is, man, I'm way going crazy. Forget all that. Selfishness on their part. Because the United States, they wanted us to help them and do all these different things. Because we're good people and we should do those kind of things. But for us, as believers in Christ Jesus, if we put as much effort into political stuff and all these different things, into being present with the Lord, it would change everything. We would have a greater impact in this world than ever before if we'd quit worrying about what Washington, D.C. does or Sacramento or whatever, and we would just be present with the Lord. we would be like Daniel and Nehemiah, and we'd be praying for the forgiveness of all the sins of our people, and we would be seeking to be a light for the kingdom of God. That's really what this is about. So Daniel chapter 11, there's three truths about God in these first 20 verses. God and his work are evident in these first 20 verses. First, God knows the future precisely, and in his wisdom reveals measured portions of his knowledge to his people. And I want you to see that, reveals measured portions. Because I believe if we knew it all, we'd be in trouble. The other thing is, I believe that that's where faith comes in. If we do it all, then why would we have faith? Does that make sense? Measured portions. Second, God keeps his covenant by bringing a just punishment requiring an extended and hostile foreign domination of his people. Why? Because he wants his people to turn back to him. Trying to get our attention. You've heard me say it. You've heard other pastors say it. You've heard evangelists say it. All kinds of people say it. You don't want God to be the one getting your attention. No. Then third, it is futile. Did I spell it right? Yeah, futile for God's people to seek safety in the violent plans of powerful kings that die with them rather than in God's work and kingdom. Here's the deal. Right here, as Paul Harvey would say, we know the rest of the story. We knew whose side to be on. You don't got to jump ship. You don't got to worry about which side of the fence you're on. You just need to surrender to one person. That's Jesus Christ. Because he will be victorious. No matter what's going on, no matter how bad it looks, no matter what you perceive or what other people tell you, Jesus Christ is the victor. And he is the one that we need to follow. So the question for us today is, are you trusting in God to be your deliverer? Or do you look to other individuals and things to give you security? Yeah, we got to trust God because he's the only one. And see, we can see how easy it is for us to be sidetracked and how easy it is, especially us. Man, we live in the land of plenty. I mean, we are so blessed. So blessed. But Lord, help us that we take it so for granted. Even in being so blessed, it's easy for us to take our eyes off of Christ. It's easy for us to not seek first his kingdom and his righteousness all the time. It's so easy for us to be like the Bible says, a lust for power, a lust for wealth, a lust for all these different things. It's easy to be driven by a lust for possessions when the only things that we need to chase after is a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's what makes a difference. Well, thank you for bearing with me today, and next week we'll finish out Daniel chapter 11, and I hope through this series on Daniel that you've gained some wisdom and some insight on who our God is and what our God is doing. But the bottom line is, from Genesis chapter 1 to the end of Revelation, it's all about Jesus. And if you're not in relationship with him, it's never too late. Well, not right now anyway. Someday it will be too late. But right now, yes, Terry. That's right. What's the influence that you left behind? Was the people's lives that you've touched, people that you've led to Jesus Christ? Very important. Hey, as we close out and pray today, there's again lots of things going on. Stammy, that some of you guys have met and got to know, she's gone through a couple different cancer surgeries. She's back in Napa. She's going through a lot of different things. And so we just need to continue to pray for God's healing in her life. And then Mike and Kathy Martinez, that used to rent Martera Banquets from us, their son was in a serious motorcycle crash over a week ago, broke a ton of his body up. I got to see him this week. He is doing better, but he's going to have to go through several surgeries himself, a lot of things going on. So want to lift him up. And then also Mary for her back. Continue to pray for Tom. And I know different things that are going on, but we just need to continue to seek God. And he will make a difference in everything. Amen. Father God, we praise you and we worship you and we honor you today. And Lord, as difficult as it might be to understand from our limited minds sometimes what you're at work doing, Lord, I thank you that you have given us words in your scripture to guide us, to help us, to prepare us for what's coming. Lord, that you haven't just set us out here wondering what is next going to happen, but Lord, you've given us your promises. You've made a covenant with us, a covenant that you won't break. And so, Lord, again, no matter what is going on in the world, no matter what's happening, we don't have to worry because our faith, our trust, and our hope is in you. And so, Lord, I pray that you would just continue to guide us and direct us on that. Lord, I pray that we grow in our walk with you, that through these different series and through the book of Daniel, Lord, that as a core of Sunrise, that we would grow in our knowledge, in our walk with you, Lord, that we would feel more at home every day of sharing our faith with other people and being Christ just to everybody. And so, Lord, that's my hope, that's my wish, that's my prayer, Lord, and I know that you're the one that can make it happen, that you're the one who changes hearts, that you're the one that transforms minds, that you're the one that makes a difference. And so today, Lord, we call on you and seek you in every way. Lord, there's many things going on, people that need prayer, people that need emotional healing, people that need restoration of relationships. Lord, we know that there's nothing you can't do, and so we pray in the name of Jesus for you to heal in each and every situation, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would go and mend hearts and allow forgiveness to happen and let deliverance to happen and all kinds of things that need to happen to restore relationships, Lord, that you would be involved in that process. And then, Lord, today for physical healing, we know that your word says that by your stripes we're healed. We claim that healing over Stammy and Mike Jr. and Mary and Tom and different ones, Lord, that have gone through medical things, physical things, Lord, that you would continue to bring healing and restoration in each of their lives. Lord, we love you. We thank you. But Lord, I pray that no matter how many distractions happen, that we would be able to keep our eyes on you. Lord, nudge us in the back, whatever it takes. If you have to get our attention, Lord, that we would not take our eyes off of you and that we would allow you to be the number one thing, because we know that you are going to be victorious in the end, and you're victorious right now. And we thank you for that, and thank you for what you've done in each and every one of our lives. Lord, today, as we have an opportunity to give back in our tithes and offering, we just thank you, Lord, that as you bless us, again, something that we take for granted, all the financial blessings that we have, Lord, that you just ask us to give back, to keep the church going, to keep things moving, to build your kingdom. And so, Lord, we do that with a grateful and a sincere heart today. And, Lord, again, we thank you for what you've done and what you're going to continue to do. In your Son Jesus' precious name, amen. The cross has spoken.